God. Come on here. Yes. All right, let's do this. All right. All right, all right, all right, family, let's go. Hello, hello, hello. Okay, wait a minute, let me get this right. Hi. Hello, hello. Let me get this phone right. Okay. Is my phone going a different way, y'all? Do I look sideways? Am I straight? I'm ready. I'm ready. Come on. Hello. Hello. What's up? What's up? What's up, peeps? Am I straight or am I upside down? Do I look sideways? Can you check me out first? Hello. Hello. Hey, big sis. How y'all doing? I'm excited about tonight. Woo! I'm straight. Okay. I don't look sideways. I'm good. I'm good, Apostle. Okay. All right. Hello, 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 hello. I'm excited about tonight, child. I'm excited. Yes.
Thank you for tuning in to the Breaking the Chains Radio.
Woo, woo!
Dr. Yolanda Sherman.
Hey, family. How y'all doing? Hey, hey. Hey, Anna Marie. How y'all doing? Apostle, my big sis, Dr. Allison Wiley, Anna Marie. Hello. I seen, who did I see? Prophetess Zandra, how are you? Hello, hello. Listen, listen, listen. I'm so excited tonight. Y'all tuned in at a good time of Breaking the Chains radio broadcast. We have some exciting, phenomenal, God-fearing women. Oh, my God, that is coming on. I'm excited about this exclusive tonight. Listen. Y'all want to stay on because this is some deep stuff that we're going to be talking about, and they have a project. Hello, 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 and I'm excited. And the project is about the role of an intercessor, and it's broken down into so many components, and I'm excited that they are allowing yours truly to interview them. So tune in to the radio station. I'm live. But listen, if you're not watching the broadcast, go to RhemaGospelRadio.com. Oh my God. Go to RhemaGospelRadio.com. Listen, listen. I have some exciting guests tonight. We have none other than Dr. Lavella McGeer. Oh, my God. We have Apostle Kelly Hennings. We have Minister Nicole Hunter. We also have Prophetess Sandra Osborne. We have Minister Jesse Burtz. And we have Dr. Verinda Williams. Come on, y'all. Welcome our guests on tonight. Welcome our guests on tonight. Woo! We are live. Listen, as Dr. McGeary on, we are doing a live phone interview. They are live at 5. Hello, you there, Doc?
Yes, Dr. Dr. Sherman, I'm here. God bless you.
Can y'all hear Doc? Woo!
Yes, we're here. We're excited. It's going to be fire on tonight.
Yes, I'm excited. I'm excited. Y'all, listen, this is Dr. Lavella Margieri. I'm so excited about her. Let me give you a little information. Dr. Lavella Margieri empowers women globally to live life intentionally by tapping into the power of intentional thinking. We better get our thought process right when she get through with us, y'all. All right, her story is one of transcendence, existing beyond the cultural norm. It is not about living, but living life intentionally. Y'all, we better do stuff intentionally. That's what Dr. Lavella is telling us. Dr. Lavella is an acclaimed international speaker and author, but most people know her as an agent of change. When an extraordinary message that transforms life, her message is simple. Oh, I like this here. She say, move in the cut. All right. Redefinition of you. It's about embracing change, reinvention, redefining, and the renewing of the minds. So, Dr. Lavella, I'm so excited about y'all being a guest on tonight. I am most grateful to you on tonight. And this is a great project that you and the ladies, oh my God, have embarked upon. Why don't you tell us what inspired you or motivated you or you know, for this project to come together? I'm so excited about it.
So thank you again. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you for inviting us. It was just part of the team that's on here tonight. We have a team of authors that are stretched out throughout the state. And in regards to the project, I did this teaching a couple months ago in reference to the role of an intercessor.
Wow.
And I did the teaching and the audio was circulating. And one of friends on Facebook, she hit me up one day, Dr. Pastor Tracy.
Wow.
And she said, Pastor, do you have that book in writing? And I said, you know, I don't, but I can do that. I can put it in writing for you.
Wow.
And in doing so, God said, why don't you, well, I heard the voice of the Lord. He said, why don't you write a book for the emerging intercessors.
Wow.
Those that are coming out of the obscurity, out of the backside of the desert, out of the dry places.
Wow.
And he gave me, when I said he not only spoke to me, but he showed me that the book or series of books would be in place for intercessors.
Wow.
5-10 years from now. That's 1-to-1, identify who they are.
Wow.
Trying to figure out by sense of identity or symbolism. And when they're looking for one or a vision that's parallel to them, that sounds like me, that looks like me,
wow,
they still don't know who they are. So they're following echoes and they're following dimensions, which is the anointing. But when they get close enough, that's still not me. So in doing so, they're able to see, well, I am that spot.
Wow.
I am that marketplace intercessor. I am that Instagram intercessor. I am that apostolic intercessor.
Wow.
But upon looking for the, at the forefathers of the spiritual mothers and fathers of the faith, they're going for the depth of the knowledge of revelation to interpret who they are, but they're still trying to fine-tune, fit in, like a puzzle. Who am I? What's my function? What's
wow.
my role? What realm, what capacity,
yes.
What when I said demographics am I called to, what region, what nation am I called to? So
wow.
they have all these questions, and they're going through and fro, and God said, write the book to make the plane, and so in doing so, we gathered the, I just put it out there, and we had intercessors that came in and said, I would like to be a part of that book.
Wow.
It's powerful, it's meaty, it has so much depth to it, but it also brings forth in simplicity. It causes one to think, to relate, and interpret, and they can also understand, well, this sounds like me. I'm going, I'm having these symptoms. I'm birthing, but I don't know what I'm birthing. And in doing so, it helps one to understand. I remember when I was birthing, I didn't know how to identify it.
Wow.
I was going to the store and buying a whole bunch of NyQuil doctors and trying to figure out what's going on. I was sick. And it took the spiritual mother to tell me, "Sir, daughter, you're not sick. You're going through birthing." Well, how was
My God.
She went through it for her to see and know the symptoms.
Yes.
This is what you're going through.
Yes.
So that's what this project is about, to bring about an enlightenment, to cause one to know the function, the depth, the root, and the mandate, why you're called for such a time in this.
Yes.
And how God will use their voice not only to facilitate shift.
Yes.
But also
yes.
shift within the shift. So they have to know with the perfect manifesto that they will decree and declare some things to bring things into fruition.
Yes.
By being their ears are inclined to the Father.
Come
and
on here.
Not only petition in Him, but because they have a relationship, they will speak with God's consciousness. And He will hear His sound, you will hear His voice.
Oh,
so I'm excited about the voices. I'm excited about the depth, the knowledge, and the mantle that has come together with this project. Yes, ma'am.
That is so amazing because, you know, when kingdom minds come together and do this that the Father has called you to do so graciously. Yeah. Oh my God, it's just amazing. You know, I tell people all the time, you know, we all have a kingdom assignment. We all have something that the Father has called us to do. You understand what I'm saying? And so we have to use it to glorify His name. But also, you know, how we say it, we bring awareness. We need to bring awareness to the body of Christ for things that's going on. And intercession is very, very crucial, especially in times like these of what's going on around us. I mean, it is very, very crucial that we be in intercession on behalf of the people. You don't hear what I'm saying. And so just to, you know, just to be with other kingdom-minded people and watch what it is that the Father is unfolding, you know, in the lives of so many is something else. And I'm excited about this interview on tonight. I'm just like, oh my God, do it, Daddy, do it, Daddy. They closing this down, saying we can't have this many people in this place and that place. But the Father, let me tell you something. Baby, when it's about His business, won't He do it?
Yes,
I said, Lord, do it, Daddy, do it. And he doing. So I'm excited about tonight. And I know with you, you wrote about the mind of an intercessor. And we're going to talk about that, you know, a little bit later on, you know what, better yet, just tell us a little bit about the mind of an intercessor, because y'all, we have bought 5 different segments. Don't y'all run out of here. Don't run out of here tonight, because this some good stuff. Sometime we need to learn. If you stop learning, hello, somebody, you stop growing. Are you hearing me? I'm forever learning. God is forever teaching. Yes. Come on here. Come on. Give us a little bit on the mind of the intercessor. I know that's in the first one of the first chapters of this book. Oh, my God.
Sometimes as intercessors, we focus on taking on His heart.
Yes.
And having that heart of compassion, that heart of mercy, and knowing His pulse, His heartbeat, that we forget that we also have to transform our mind. It's the scripture said, you know, being transformed by the renewing of our mind.
Yes.
But upon the more we enter into His presence and we take on the imagery of Him, the shape, the form of Him, our fragrance changes, our language changes, our posture changes.
Wow.
And in doing so, we no longer, it's just... you know, beating His Father, I need this, have to be done, the bills, this, that. At this point, He's wanting to hear an echo of Himself. He wants to hear His voice. He's wanting to hear His mind, His consciousness. So the more time you spend with Him, is the more time, the more you're in the meditative mode, that you are now hearing His thoughts, and we call it revelation, or download, or mind hack. And because it's downloading in us, it's now, for some, it'll be overwhelming. For some, you'll feel the presence, the weight, the heaviness of the anointing. But hearing His thoughts, that's our voice. Now, in doing so, when we hear His thoughts, hit our thoughts originally, predestinately. It overrides our consciousness. It overrides every narrative that they told us that we wouldn't be, couldn't be, and you're not that person, or, you know, that the spread of death or the spread of suicide or every narrative that came to cancel out your assignment and to kill and annul you, is that voice, that consciousness, that prophetic voice. It overrides, which means it changes the languages. Now we start speaking an Asterion of who he is. Now he's hearing his voice. We take on the fragrance of him when we change the posture of who we are.
My God.
So everything in us yields, our mind, our body, and soul. So when he's looking to hear his voice, his frequency, his sound, his depth. Too many times we run to him, Abba, 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 in regards to what we're dealing with in our daily lives, but those are low-hanging fruits. What are we going to speak in the height, the depth of of our ascender plate, looking down? And when we do that, we come to find out it's really not a problem. And we just have to go through different temperaments and different environments.
Yes.
But he really wants us to be in a place where everything that we think is a problem or a burden is not even a problem or a burden. Because his assignment in earth realm, his mandate, kingdom governance is our priority. But how do we do that? When we fine-tune ourselves.
Yes.
When we are one, not a rhetoric or a vibration.
Yes.
And as we hear an echo, and it's a vibration of himself, we are in tune.
Yes.
We move in him and have his being.
Yes.
And so in doing so, we then now echo his voice, the frequency, the depth. We are one with him. We move with him.
Yes.
We don't see obstacles. We don't see what the world system is saying or what they're doing.
Yes.
We are moving with the timing. We become time.
Yes.
When we are take on his consciousness, we become time for everybody else, aligning them to God's sequential time.
Wow.
So that's what we have to do, take on his mind, his mindset.
Oh, my God.
His intelligence.
Taking on the mindset. Listen, you guys, that's round one. Oh, that's round one. Oh my God. Come on, Maestro. Give me a little something, because I'm telling you, we about to go in to the Issachar Intercessor. Apostle Kelly Hennings. Oh my God, y'all don't want to miss. Put my jams on, Maestro. Y'all don't want to miss. Y'all don't want to miss.
This ain't no game, this show ain't no joke. This mess I bring.
Come on.
Woo! I'm going to shout it all around to hear. One step to Christ and hear.
Woo!
You want your life to change, you want to be free from sin.
Come on here.
You want the water and spirit to make it in. Hell is hot and
hot. Oh, you feeling yourself. Come on, it's all about intercession. It's all about intercession. It's all about intercession. Get your house in order. Come on here. Y'all know it's Friday Night Live. Come on here. Yeah. God, today, my God, today, we just finished listening to Dr. Lavella McGeer. Oh, my God, she took us on in with the mind of an intercessor, but she also told us about the overall, hello, family, the overall project. My God, the role of an intercessor. We need intercession. Come on here. Come on here. My next guest, oh, my God, OMG, OMG, is the none other than Apostle Kelly Hennings. Let me tell you a little bit about this anointed vessel. Apostle Kelly Hennings travels the world fulfilling her passion and purpose of loving people back to life. She is a pastor, an entrepreneur, an author, an entertainer, and most importantly, a worshiper after God's own heart. Can you hear me? Holler up in here for the worshipers. I just talked to y'all about worship. We just went in yesterday. And here go Apostle, importantly, a worshiper. Pastor Kelly is the senior pastor at Impact One International Ministries in Elkhart in and Nairobi, Kenya. Apostle Kelly is a human rights advocate with a passion for giving back and believes in the compassion of Holy Spirit delivering it to those who need it the most. Pastor Kelly is the co-founder of Neighbors, Orphans, and Widows Foundation, Now Inc., a nonprofit organization which exists to foster healing and give a voice to those who have been silenced from all forms of abuse, poverty, trauma, and human trafficking. She's also an advocate partner of One Wing Foundation, which provides aid for those receiving treatment who have survived breast cancer. Pastor Kelly has been featured in numerous magazines and radio shows. She is truly a living testimony of God's redemption plan in action and power to heal. Pastor Hennings travels internationally, training and equipping people to successfully fulfill their divine purpose. She has a diverse background in business, prophetic counseling, consulting, pastoring, and teaching, which gives, oh my God, she's a bad girl, y'all. Her unique leadership insights and perspectives. Kelly has a passion to use her experience and her prophetic gift to assist world leaders in achieving their goals and accomplishing their visions. She has a passion for winning souls. Now you talking my language. Winning souls and leading global revivals, crusades, and missions annually. Rhema, welcome. Come on, welcome Apostle Kelly Hennings. Woo! Apostle Kelly Hennings, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Wow. Listen, I was reading something and it just kind of just blessed me. It's even in the beginning where you say, let us prepare our hearts for the Issachar intercessors and prophets who will usher us into divine favor and unprecedented revival. Then if you go down a little bit, it say we will no longer be chained to moves of the past because of the Issachar intercessor will open to the newness of God and instrumental in the wealth distribution plan of God to his people. OMG. Lord have mercy. Apostle Kelly, how are you? And welcome to the broadcast.
I am well. I'm having a good time in Houston. It's kind of cold in Indiana.
You in Indiana? Oh, my God. It's cold down there?
I'm in Houston right now.
Oh, you're in Houston right now?
I'm in Houston. Enjoying the weather.
Enjoying the weather. Oh, my God. Listen. Can you briefly you know, give us a little bit of your insight on the Issachar Intercessor. I mean, this is so powerful to me. I love the fact that it talks about being instrumental and going into the newness and, you know, ushering people into new mindsets and understanding of the anointing, especially in pivotal times. I'm reading this and I'm just like, wow, oh my God. Because people need to know different ways that we can intercede on behalf of God's people.
Amen. The Issachar Intercessor is somebody that stays in the face of God. They live to be in the presence of God. God does nothing in the earth without first revealing unto his servants, the prophets. The beauty about the Issachar Intercessor is they're not just the people that say, yeah, they'll pray for you. Those are the people that pray with you and then jump in the trenches to help you get through to the other side.
Come on here.
They're God's army and his support system for the movers and shakers in the kingdom. But being in the presence of God, they are downloaded with the strategies and they release those downloads to the people around them, to the tribes around them. They may have different skill sets, but they don't have the time or the ear to hear from God of the things that they've been called to do. So they impart wisdom. They let you know God's wealth distribution plan and how you fit into it, but they are always shifting and moving as God is leading.
Wow. Jesus. And it says here, it says the Issachar Intercessor knows how to identify a fresh anointing, atmosphere shifts, and a mantle and a mandate changes.
Come on.
Oh my God. Can you kind of elaborate on that a little bit? Because, you know, sometimes people think that, you know, there's no freshness. God is not doing anything new. There's no shifting. You know, he's not doing anything new.
He's doing new things all the time. It's our perception and our perspective and our relationship that keeps us stuck in an old thing. And our willingness to obey. The beauty about the Issachar Intercessor is that they're always willing to obey God. And so even as God removed the mantle from King Saul to David, the Issachar Intercessor not only supported David in his coming into his own kingship, but they also were the army that was around him, protecting him, following him. They shifted as God shifted.
Wow.
When Deborah came in to lead the army, it was the Issachar Intercessors that stood with her and Barak. They were the first ones to stand with a woman who was making unprecedented moves in the kingdom. And so the Issachar Intercessor, if you know one, if you find one, you've got to know that when they're moving and shifting, you might want to jump on board because they're already moving on to who God has already called, ordained, and equipped for a time such as this.
My God. Dr. Lavelle, you still there?
Yes, I am.
You want to jump in there?
Yes, I am.
Go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. And when you said when they are able, they moved with Deborah. What do you mean? They're moving this in syncopated in their anointing, or they're moving with the syncopation of time, God's time in the earth realm?
They move syncopated with heaven, and they were already equipped to transition to follow her before anybody else knew that she was the person that God had anointed to lead an army.
My God.
And when moving with heaven, they not only move as a wind, but they implemented, which means there was a shift within the shift. When we hear the Issachar anointing, we're thinking about time and syncopation of time. But as they move as an army, they move as a nation, they move as a unit, they move as a team. And in doing so, well, it's very, we speak of a militant God. That was a militant move. So some will think, well, we're waiting on his timing, his confirming timing. But what do you have to say when they move militantly?
Mm.
They are strong in faith. They are loyal, they're united. Their trademark is the donkey. And so those are the people that will do the hard work. They're ready to engage in battle. They're already prayed up. They've already established themselves in heavenly places. They have positioned themselves to be the frontline soldiers. They're doing tactical and strategic warfare all the time. They carry the heavy artillery in prayer. And they know how to make the set person look good while they do the hard labor.
Hey!
So how would that, and what we're dealing with today, pertaining to those that have the Issachar anointing, that would fit right, when I said right in, because the Creator always allowed crisis in the earth realm to raise a prophetic voice or voices.
Yes.
So his glory could be known, which means there's a wave of glory. The wave is higher. There's another wave of glory. There's another higher depth to it. And so there's always a earth crisis that ushers in the freshness, the newness. So what would you say God is doing now pertaining to what we're the world system is dealing with today?
Yes.
God is settling the order of sonship in the earth. In this time, we're seeing those who have like minds and like faith, and we see those that are falling away from the faith, no matter what position of prominence they may be in. God is drawing the hearts of fathers back to sons and sons back to fathers. When you have all these children that are out of school and they're at home, he's forcing us to begin to teach our children again and not rely on a system to teach them, because we're responsible to train our children up in the way that he would have us to go. I have been telling the members of my church for 2 years to stock up and store up, because there is something that's coming, and you don't have time to be in the grocery store lines, because you're going to need to have everything you need at home so you can be postured in prayer for what's coming. And now it's here. There's so many times where we're missing moves of God because our ears are not in tune to the right frequency with God. And you have to have an open mind to hear fresh voices that are releasing things
Jesus.
That don't line up or match up with the old wineskins that you're accustomed to listening
Jesus.
To. God can't pour new wine into old wineskins.
Come on,
rupture. And so now we have a situation where we have people that were not healed or were not delivered, that did not have clean hands and pure hearts before
Come on,
the Lord.
Yeah.
And so they were not receiving what was happening in these pivotal times.
Jesus.
And then you have the no-name somebodies that were saying what was about to happen all along, and nobody had an ear to hear.
Come on.
And so our system literally imploded because we based our foundation on people like Eli, who had not been in the presence of God.
Jesus.
And God was no longer using him. He was raising up a Samuel in the midst to,
Come
to
on, yeah.
anoint new voices, to be a fresh voice, to establish order and judgment in the earth realm. And
Jesus.
So we've got to always be posturing and asking God, who has the goods in this season? Who's got the Jews? And
Jesus.
Who has a voice to reach beyond the four walls of the church? Because in this season, the people aren't coming. We have to have a mind to go ye out in the hedges of highways and byways.
Come on here. Come on in.
I couldn't stay seated comfortably in my home in Indiana when there were people who needed what was in my belly.
Jesus, Jesus.
And so sometimes you got to take a flight. You got to get on the airplane. You got to be uncomfortable for a minute.
Come
so
on.
So that God can release what he needs in the region that he needs it.
My God. When it's time to move and God is saying move, we better be attentive to his voice. We better obey. You know, I tell people all the time about obeying the voice of the Father, because we miss it when we are not attentive to hearing what the Father is speaking. You understand what I'm saying? To be able to follow the instruction. So intercession, prayer is very, very important. I was looking over something else and you said in the book, and I like this because it says a primary focal point of the Issachar intercessor would be turning their eyes to the next generation and the unlearned. Their prayers will be answered by the demonstrations of God pouring out his spirit up on all flesh. They will cry loud and spare not as mantles are passed to win generation after generation. Oh my God, you know. God, you know, God is pouring out his spirit on all flesh. You know what I'm saying? He's pouring it out. He's pouring it out. You know, those who are unlearned, now is the time that we got to tap in there. You understand what I'm saying? And teach them so that they may learn of him and learn of his ways. Oh my God, this has been this is good. This is amazing. And another thing, at the end of it, you said that they will intercede and intercept as the word of God perfect the lives of his children to the end of the days. My God, we got to be watchmen on the wall. I'm looking around. Women of Valor, I'm a part of Women of Valor. They're praying for 40 days. Pastor Johnson and Lady Gail Johnson, their church is praying. My church, Great Emmanuel Family Worship Center, there are people out there who are praying. They're interceding. It's time to be interceding on behalf of the people. Oh, my God. We got to come to a break, y'all. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. This is getting good. Let me tell you something. Get ready, get ready, get ready, get ready. Our next person that we're getting ready to come on board is Minister Nicole Hunter. We will be talking about the scribe intercessor. All right, give us a... Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm so sorry, Apostle Kelly. Thank you for coming on. I am so sorry. Thank you for coming on. It's been a long day. Thank you so much for your insight and your wisdom that you are giving to the people on tonight. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Blessings. Come on, Maestro, come on with my jams. Come on, put your hands together.
Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You've been so good. When I look back over my life. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, Lord.
Yeah.
the person you can see. You got a phone number for the person you can see.
I was about to take off running up in here, y'all. I was about to take off running. Listen. This is amazing night. Oh, my God. This is amazing night. And we have another special guest, Minister Treve Nicole Hunter. Can we give her a welcome? Can we give her a rhema welcome? Minister Treve, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Blessings. You, let me give them a little bit about you. All right. Minister Treve Nicole is a singer, a songwriter, a poet, and an author. Y'all, she from Houston, so look her up. All right. The best way to describe her ministry is by explaining who she is as a worshiper. She gonna make me pass out. All right. She is inspired by the belief in true and pure worship is what breaks the yokes of bondage off of people. Her life and work are patterned by the fact that worship is the key to unlocking every door, chain, and bolt. Her songs, her poems, her books are aimed at speaking truth to every situation, that truth being the heart of God. Treve is an author of a book, These Words, 2015, Dear Daughter, and her most recent publishing, License to Carry. Oh, my God. She has performed at events such as Queens of the Mic at the Houston Improvement Shift Christian Lounge and Houston Gospel Fest 2019, where she performed her single, Shift the Place, 2019. Treve has been a guest host on Rhema Gospel Radio, The Blueprint with Be Well, Amazing 102.5 FM, Inspiration Sundays with the Word Magician, The Weekend Praise Part. Boy, she got a his internet, radio, Up Social Live, I Like TV, Rivers Author Showcase. Lord have mercy, this girl just got worship everywhere. Can I just sum it up? What's up? Y'all, listen. God, Jesus, I was reading something and it talks about the scribes, and you saying the scribes were visionaries, and symbols that they carved and paintings were a visual depiction of what's being said. The visual word brought meaning to the spoken word. All of the creation is a visual depiction that brings meaning to the spoken word of God. Why don't you elaborate on the role of a scribe intercessor? Because people need to know these different aspects. I'm really having a ball today, y'all. Y'all just don't know. We just all out the box. You understand? We all out the box. We all out the box. Let's dive in now. The role of a scribe. Why it exists.
The role of a scribe, this person exists to make God, the word of God, the spoken word of God and the written word of God that's in the Bible, to make it plain, like he told Habakkuk in the Bible. We were created, we are the word of God. He spoke us into existence. And so the scribe intercessor has to understand that people, just like God has said, it says in the word that people will hear the word, they won't understand. They'll see the word, they won't be able to perceive what it is that it means. But the scribe intercessor has to understand that we are braille to the people that are blind, that are reading the word of God and don't understand what it is that they're reading.
Wow.
And we are sign language to the people who cannot hear.
Wow.
And who cannot understand. And so we are the demonstration of what it is God is trying to say. The scribe intercessor has to be able to hear what God is saying, and they have to be able to see what it is that God is trying to do, especially in times like this, what's going on right now. And they have to be able to demonstrate. So they have to be able to pretty much transcribe, they have to be able to interpret what it is that's going on in order to tell the people. And the thing that I like the most that God showed me was that scribes don't just write. They don't just record data. They had to study, they had to teach, and they had to interpret the law.
Wow.
And we know that in today, we know back then that they couldn't understand everything that was being said because Jesus had to speak to them in parables. But on today, there's so many different learning disabilities that are out there now. And I'm sure there are more that we'll discover as we move on into the future. But the scribe has to be able to make it plain, to make plain what it is that God is trying to say in every circumstance and in every situation and every type of weather. That is what the importance of the scribe intercessor is.
My. It says here, scribes are opening ears by opening eyes to dialogue that is taking place between the heart of God and the heart of the people. Inside the heart resides the issues of life. OMG. Also, it is an intercessor person who stands in the gap for someone. How many of us right now are standing in the gap for somebody? What kind of picture are we painting? OMG. This is just so amazing. You know, Habakkuk, what he say, write the vision, make it plain. Gotta write it, gotta make it plain. You understand what I'm saying? Oh my God. I was reading something else. It says, the scribe intercessor intercedes for the people through the written word. Through the written word of God. Through the written word of God. What are some of your most pivotal times as a scribe intercessor that God has used you to be an impact to somebody else's life?
Wow. One of the things that I am a firm believer of is that demonstration precedes manifestation.
Hey, that's good right there.
And in the Bible, not all of the prophets and people that God called were scribes. They had the scribe right next to them in order to write down what was being said and what they had to get across to the people. But what did happen with the prophets is they had to go through things in order for themselves to understand what it is that God was trying to say, what message God wanted them to deliver to the people. And in my own life, there were a lot of things that I had to go through. And it's only after the fact, whenever I had to write Dear Daughter, that is when I really realized this. It's only after the fact that I realized, okay, I'm writing the things that happened to me, and this is how it applies to other people's lives. Now, this is what God is trying to say. This is the message that He's trying to give through what I just went through.
My.
And this is how I have to put it. Otherwise, if I'm just giving a testimony, I may just speak out of emotion.
Yeah.
But I have to really understand what God is saying. Why is God taking me through this? What is He really trying to say to me? And then what is the message that I'm supposed to be portraying to the other people?
Wow. Ooh, Lord have mercy. This right here is good. This is good. What is one thing that you would encourage a person right now, as you being a person that's a, you know, into being a scribe intercessor? What is the one thing that you would tell somebody else at this point to help them along the way?
From the standpoint of the scribe, in the Word of God, it talks about how a woman, one of my favorite scriptures, is that she's clothed in strength and dignity. And I think that we have to come to realize that we wake up every day and we put on clothes and we walk out into the world, but it's important to remember what we're really putting on.
Wow.
Because the clothing, we'll remember what somebody has on, what they had on yesterday, if we liked it, if we were interested in it, or if we didn't like it, if it stood out to us. But the things that stay stuck in our minds are the words that people say to us. Wow. And so I think it's important to understand and know the Word of God and who He says that we are, and speak those words over ourselves every day. And not just, and that there's more people today that are wearing clothing that has scripture on it, that has different messages on it. If we have to write it on the tag of our clothes, if we have to write it on the bottom of our feet, we need to be able to have the word written in our mind.
Wow.
And take it with us everywhere that we go. Make it visible to ourselves everywhere that we go. I think that is really important when it comes to living our lives out each and every day. There's something different. There's a different challenge that we're going to face every day. And there's some things that hit us, and we don't even know that it hit us until later when we're going through. But if we are able to have the word, it's supposed to be written on our hearts, we're able to keep it inside of our mind, then we're able to stay encouraged.
Wow. Well, I thank you. Oh, my God. Thank you. Thank you for being a part of the broadcast on today. Our hearts is blessed. I'm thankful for the information that is being given to the people, because knowledge is power, y'all. Knowledge is power.
It is.
Amen. Blessing, blessing.
Dr. Leo, if I may, I have a quick question. What would you tell the scribes that thinking that they're living in an illusion and they're in dream state, because what they're seeing, they can't describe it or share it because it'll be too much of an information to share, because one would think that they're, one, losing their mind, two, they've lost it. Doesn't make sense. So they're dismissed. They're in a place where they're always being dismissed. But they're walking in dream state, writing, because when they're walking in dream state, because they're the Word of God is very, like, it's like tattooed, inscriptive upon their hearts and upon their skin.
Mm-hmm.
But they feel the agony. They feel the agony, the suicidal thoughts. What the earth groanings, what they're feeling, they're seeing what's about to happen, what's about to manifest. And especially for those that have been writing about what we're experiencing now, they wrote this 5-10 years ago, and here it is now, we're manifesting it, we're seeing it. Some of them wasn't able to see it. What about those emerging scribes that's going through it, but they're about to lose their mind because they can't share it because it's too much, and what they're seeing is dark, but yet it's very detailed, and they have so much symbolism, color-coded, Greek, Hebrew, and yet they can't tell or share. What would you tell that emerging scribe that's going through that?
I think that it's important that we learn. I mean, I can speak from experience. When I'm going through something, I remember and I think about and I pray to God and ask Him, who in the Bible went through this? Who can you show me that went through this so that I know what I need to do, so that I can be encouraged? I know that I'm not alone, so I know that this is you, and I know that I'm not just by myself, because you get in a point when you have all that going on, you feel like you're alone and like you're by yourself, and no one's going to believe this. And I would say to think on and remember those people who God gave words to, who God told to tell people certain things. He warned Ezekiel that you're gonna go, you're going to go and you're going to eat this scroll, and it was bitter. It was sweet, mm-hmm. and it was bitter. And he told them, the people are going to rebel. They're going to tell mm-hmm. you that you're crazy. They're not going to listen to you. But yet he still had to do what God yeah. told him to. He still had to say what God told him to. And they have to be encouraged by who's already gone before them.
Come on.
And they have to know that it's not just about what's happening right now. As I said, in my chapter, there were several times where, I think it was the book of Isaiah, where it talks about the time in the present when he was writing, but there were some things that didn't match up with the timeline. Some things were talking about the future. And so we have to remember that we're not just, especially now, and I can speak because I teach high school, so I know from experience, especially right now, we're not just riding to the situation that's going on right now, the circumstances going on right now, no yes. matter how bad it seems. We're riding to future generations.
Yes.
There are generations coming up that are blind, yes. that are deaf, and don't want yes. to try to see or hear what it is that you have to say to them.
Yes.
But
yes.
when you write the word, that word yes. is going to be there permanently. They're going to yes. have to read that eventually. They're going to be looking for some yes. kind of direction, and that direction is going to be coming from the word you were obedient and wrote down.
Yes, yes, God yes. told yes. you to. Yes. Ooh, this is good. We got another segment, y'all. We got another segment. Oh, my good. Thank you so much for that information. This is so powerful. Our next segment, oh, my God, the birthing and the midwife intercessor, Prophetess Sandra Osborne. Oh, my God. We are transitioning. Let's take a break.
Whatever satisfies me, it doesn't please you. Lord, I pray, come and take it away. Take it away. Take it away.
People tell me, come to your own light, you can do greater. This conviction, mi wakugamba tobi wa atesoni, si ano damu te jenjala kodi gosa kati tuno.
Atu God's ways, he can da puta puta Lord, and choose you the rest of the world. I can't let you go.
My God, my God, this the next segment. We have none other. We want to welcome to Rhema Gospel Radio, Prophetess Sandra Osborne, the birthing and midwife intercessor. Blessings, family. Let me give you a little bit about Prophetess Sandra Osborne.
Hello.
Hold on, just a commercial break, right?
Quick. Okay.
KOERLB 101.5 FM, Cypress, Texas. KOERLB 101.5 FM, Cypress, Texas.
All right, here we go, here we go. Prophetess Sandra Osborne is an anointed woman of God, appointed for such a time as this. She accepted the Lord at an early age and enjoys serving God's people as a youth choir president, a youth leader. She is pursuing her psychology at Houston Community College. Minister Sandra strives to be an example of a virtuous woman a woman who has yielded to God in every area of her life. Minister Zandra enjoys being a loving helpmate to a husband of 19 years, Donald. She ministers to her two adult children, Xavier and Marquise, and loves her three precious grandchildren and one more soon to come. Yeah. Prophetess Zandra is the founder of Midwife Sessions and Eagle Wings Faith Ministries Incorporated. She operates fluently in the prophetic office as well as in the areas of healing and deliverance. She is also a powerful prayer warrior who possesses the heart of a worshiper, resulting in divine revelations and manifestations of the Holy Spirit, not only in her personal life, but also in the lives of others. She has also been a nurturing mentor to women of all walks of life over the years. Minister Zandra continues to aim toward and produce excellence in all of her ministry opportunities. Her desire is to see God's people grow and go forward as they fulfill the kingdom of God's mandate on their lives. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Oh, my God. OMG. Midwife intercessor. Now, y'all know, women, oh, my God, when you got to birth something out, you know that there's some pain to the madness, to the process. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. So, with that being said, we getting ready to talk about some of these labor pains of birthing. From we finna get some expertise from the prophetess, Prophetess Zandra Osborne. Amen. Tell the people how to push.
Yeah. For God be the glory. Thank you for having us on tonight. I appreciate it.
Well, listen, let's dive on in here. We talk about birth and we talk about pushing. We talking about birthing of intercession. You know, we praying, we seeking God, but we pushing people through with our prayers. Come on and elaborate on that.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You have to have a keen eye to know when the birth is about to take place. You have to be in a place to understand the time and the season under the sun.
My
and
God.
It's not a quick process of being a midwife, because everybody don't like that midwife. You know when you give them a natural birth, you know that pain you got to go through. And it don't feel good. Hallelujah. So when I come on the scene, it's time to be birthed, and I don't have time to play. It's time to process and birth this thing.
So what you gonna tell them? Push?
I'm gonna say it's time to birth, it's time to push. We ain't got time. We ain't got time. You've been waiting too long. The process is over. That's why we got to learn to know. Many of us been sitting in these churches for a long time. I have myself and you personally been in these churches. We sit in there, we help. I'm a type of person been behind the scenes, helping pushing everybody else. But this season, I'm coming forth. To even this, as I'm pushing myself, I'm pushing you.
Bless.
It's time to do the thing. It's time to come out of that season and saying what you can't do. It's time to do the thing right now. Hallelujah.
OMG. I've read something that say one day I was involved in a tragic car accident, and the impact and the trauma of the accident caused me to unexpectedly go into premature labor. When I went into the labor and delivery room, I heard women hollering and screaming all around me. What I didn't understand at the time was that they wasn't just screaming from the birthing pains, they were travailing. There's a difference between birthing and travailing. So explain to them the difference between birthing, hey, okay, my friend.
All right.
And travailing.
When you birth something, that's a process. When you go through that, as a woman, you know we have 9 months to deliver that thing. And when you birth something, it's a process. You at the end of that third trimester, you know you got to get ready to birth that thing. And as I was explaining now, I was young as a young woman. I did not understand what was taking place. I go in that labor room. I hear all this hollering and screaming because I was in, first of all, we being value in the process of birthing. I said I was, at that time, I didn't know. I was too ashamed to let my family know don't want to come forth.
Woo!
Same way we got some birthing in us that we do not understand.
Shonda!
We up on these pastors and leaders, and we don't, ain't nobody training us and telling us what to do. So you got to know it's a birthing process in there. And as I was speaking in the book, as a role as a midwife, it's Hannah. When Hannah came on the scene, everybody, Hannah thought she was bearing something. She had a bitterness because she couldn't birth that thing.
My God.
She began to process that thing. Hannah was ready. And when he came, when Eli came, people thought Hannah was going crazy, but Hannah was about to birth a prophet. Hallelujah. It's time to birth. So she went into a holler and screamed. She began to holler and scream out. He thought she was foolish. But she can't let travail is when you go into some anguish pain.
Hey,
I'm going to push this thing out. Hallelujah.
Come on, hell.
Begin to travail something. You got to know. I don't care if you like me or not. I don't care what you say or mama, baby said about me or whatever you category you try to.
Woo!
I'm going to go crazy. Hallelujah. I'm going to go crazy and process this thing. Hallelujah. That's the difference in birthing and travailing. Hallelujah.
OMG. Let me tell y'all something. She ain't playing with this here. She trying to tell y'all. Y'all got to push this thing out. Y'all got to push it on out. Y'all got to push it on out. Y'all got to hang on in there. Come on here. This thing that the Father trying to do with you, y'all better come on, hang on in there and push it on out. OMG, OMG. Lord have mercy. She made me want to shout up in this radio station today. I was about to get my shout on. So listen, OMG, let me tell y'all something. Whatever it is that the Father is calling you to do in this hour, do it, do it, do it. Be found doing it. All right? We want to thank you, Prophetess Zandra Osborne, the birthing and midwife intercessor. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Oh, my God, for coming
Thank you tonight.
Listen here. Now, we talking about birthing somebody. Now, we got to go off into the worship intercessor. Minister Jesse Burtz is getting ready to come on. Oh, my God, come on here, the worship intercessor. All right. Thank you so much. Thank you. Woo, let's go.
Yo, how you gonna tell me how to dance, yo? No, you didn't.
Woo! Minister Jesse. Here we go, Minister Jesse, the role of a worship intercessor, OMG. Jesse Burtz, Minister Jesse Burtz was born in Roseville, Georgia, as the only daughter alongside four brothers to Jesse and Rosa Burtz. She grew up in a family of worshipers. Her father and uncle played the guitar, and her brothers played the drums, keyboard, and guitar. Minister Jesse loved singing and worshiping God. So this, she been worshiping God all her life. Hello. And this is what she declares. Jesse declares that she is God chosen, a daughter of the Most High. Luke 1:37, for with God nothing will be impossible. Oh my God. Let's welcome Minister Jesse Burtz.
Thank you.
We're going to dive right in here. Let's talk about the role of a worship intercessor. Let's talk about the role. Tell the people the role. Why it is so important for us to be worship intercessors.
Hi. Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me. One of the things that's most important to be a worship intercessor, because you got to have a relationship with God.
Come on here.
And you can't enter into a secret place with God if you don't have a relationship with God. And when you get into that place with God, everything has to change. The climate and the atmosphere changes.
Yes.
And you have to have a spirit of worship. Those that worship God must worship in spirit and truth.
Yes.
So God is going to accept your worship when you come in adoration and adornment before the King, the Creator, the great I Am.
Yes.
Because with God, like I said, nothing is impossible. And it's just a great place when you enter into that place of praise with God. You forget about what you went in there after. You just want to be before your Father.
Jesus. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. How would you encourage the people to be a worship intercessor? What would make me want to be a worship intercessor? Are you called to it, or just something you pick up? Or tell us why. Or you?
I believe that you are called to be a worship intercessor.
Come on,
because
here.
You're standing in the gap for others, and God will call you to go and intercede on the behalf of others. He'll call you to go and intercede and worship on the behalf of your family. Things change, like you're going to go into prayer and God is going to download some things while you're in his presence. He's going to put on your heart to go pray for that family member. He's going to put on your heart to go pray for that coworker. He's going to put on your heart and give you strategic plans and positions to be in. This is a praise and worship, you're called to it because it's a mighty weapon. It's a mighty tool because you can go in and break some things through praise and intercession.
My God.
You can break up the atmosphere. You can target and destroy barriers in the atmosphere that are going on with people. You can just tear it up. Take your praise as your weapon, your sword, and damage the things in the atmosphere.
My God. Oh, my God. Come on, worship intercessors. Come on. Something ought to be stirring in your spirit to worship, intercede on behalf of others. Oh, my God. And you love to worship, huh?
Yes, I do. I am a worshiper. I used to sit in a rocking chair as a little girl, rocking into the Lord, and I didn't even know what I was doing, but I was called at a very young age to adore who he is and whom he is, and not just to adore God, but to marvel at his presence. To know that when you get in his presence, that thing has to change, that thing has to break. You get in there, if you're going to bring doubt up into the praise, there is no room for that.
Nah.
You forget about doubt. You forget about your worries. I would say in today's time, especially with this virus going on, get in a place of praise and worship and allow God to give you some peace that surpasses all understanding. Because if he's with you, he is more than those that are against you. And you're covered in the blood. You're going to be all right.
My. Lord have mercy, worship provokes change. I tell you, we got to worship. We got to worship the Father, because they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
And in truth.
Oh, my God. So this is amazing. I want to thank you so much for coming on. Oh, my God, the role of a worship intercessor. We got one more, and we got one more segment. Oh, my God. And that's it. I want to thank you for coming on and blessing the people.
Thank
you for having me. Oh, my God. This has been a blessed night. I know y'all blessed out there, because they blessing me. We just don't have enough time in the day for all this information. We're going to take a break, and we're going to return with the last segment. And let me tell y'all something. Y'all know about the marketplace, huh? We will have Dr. Verinda Williams, the Marketplace Intercessor.
Deuce, you hear me? And I ain't finna spit no game to you, straight up.
Yeah.
But look, I'm feeling your swag. I'm feeling the way you is.
Yeah.
So, come on over here. Let me talk to you right quick, alright? Let me get in here.
This is phenomenal, I'm telling y'all. Woo! My God today. My God today. Listen, listen. This, y'all, listen. My night, I don't know about y'all, but if y'all been on the whole broadcast, I'm telling you, this has been a tremendous blessing. These segments, let me tell y'all something. We don't have enough time in the day to cover all this material, but I thank God for what we're doing, bringing this to the body of Christ. I want to thank each and every one of you. Is Dr. Verinda Williams on the line?
Yes, ma'am. I am here.
We want to welcome old Doc. But I'm a little country. Forgive me. I want to thank y'all for hanging on in there to the end. Let me tell y'all something. This has been amazing. This is Dr. Verinda Williams. Let me give you a little bit about her. Dr. Verinda Williams is a daughter, a sister, a mentor, an advisor who enriches, enhances, educates, and empowers people with initiatives and innovation. This Louisiana native has a Bachelor of Science from Southern University at A&M College, where she majored in chemistry with a mathematics minor. She's educated, child. Come on here. Anointed and educated. Come on here. She also has a master's in education and educational leadership and administration from Concordia University, Portland. A graduate of Liberty School of Ministry and Bible Institution and Christian Bible Institute Seminary, also received a Doctorate of Divinity degree from International Seminary in Plymouth, Florida in 2010. She strongly believes in effective and victorious living through the precepts, statutes, and oracles of God's word without compromise. Oh, you on my street. And she has a host of other things that she's involved with. In addition, she is a prolific preacher, tenacious teacher, amazing conference speaker, certified Christian counselor, and a dynamic woman that God is using to encourage, train, and instruct the body of Christ. Throughout her 30-year ministerial tenure of preaching and teaching God's word, she has also received numerous distinctions, certificates of recognition, and congressional honors for her work with the fields of education and community service. Y'all, let's give it up. It's a lot on her resume, but let me tell you something. We thank God for the anointing that he has given her in, as a marketplace intercessor. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And so, I'm looking at something. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. This is, she asked the question, do we pray? Okay, here's the real question. Do we possess the capacity to occupy the seat of an intercessor? Here's an even more thought-provoking question. Do we fit the role or job description that qualifies us to sit in the seat of an intercessor? Now, come on and break that down.
So, first of all, thank you so much, Dr. Yolanda, for this opportunity. It has been absolutely amazing. One of the things, as a veteran educator for nearly 20 years, any time that you apply for a job, it doesn't necessarily have to be in education, but just in any sector, there is a job description, there's criteria that's set out by the company that's putting the vacancy out. And so the question is, do you meet the criteria? And so we flip that into the spiritual. Do we meet the criteria in order for us to occupy the seat of the intercessor? And so not to give the whole entire chapter away, but we do, God, do dive into some things that we need to look at to see if we fit the bill, as it were. Do we qualify to sit in the seat of the intercessor as regards to, of course, the field of education, whatever capacity that you're occupying within the field of education?
My. Oh, my God. Then you have something in here talking about the alert, the A. The word stands for alert. Come on here.
So part of the criteria.
Come on here.
One of the things, when we're talking about the role of the intercessor or an intercessor, one of the primary things that we need to understand is the importance of being alert and aware spiritually. In the book of Amos, it talks about wake up, you mighty men.
Come on
and
here.
So it is imperative, especially in this hour, that intercessors, gatekeepers, watchmen, that we are alert and we are aware to make sure that the enemy don't creep in. Territory. And so, so it causes one to look through the mirror of the Word of God and say, okay, am I really on top of my game?
Come
on
here.
Am I really on my square?
Come on here.
Am I in syncopation with you? Am I hearing you on the same frequency that I'm hearing you on?
My God. Woo! Oh, my God. So, in other words, is our spiritual antennas up?
Exactly.
Are we attentive? Can we hear?
Say, you know, when we're on our cell phones and we're moving and we're going.
Come on here.
One of the things that Holy Spirit downloaded into me just the other day, he said, daughter, I want to know, can you hear me now? So that's the thing. Can we hear him now at this given point in time? Can we hear him? Can we see him?
Then you got something else talking about targeted. Come on here. Come on here. Come on here. It say, am I specific in my petitions concerning students as I teach them daily? Baby, who is your God? Come on, educator. Am I targeted? Come on here. Am I specific? Talk to him. Come on here. Shut up. I'm about to shout up in y'all radio station.
So, of course, we know, according to the Word of God, Philippians 4 gives us a nice synopsis in terms of as we approach the Father in intercession. The Word says in Philippians 4, chapter 4, verse 6, very familiar scripture, it says, don't worry about anything, but when you present your petitions, you know, be specific when you're presenting them.
Come on here.
And so as we're going to God on behalf of, and because I'm an educator, when I go to God on behalf of my kids,
come on here.
So am I just going haphazardly, or am I specific? You know, when a person is going out
to get their gun license to carry.
Go
when
ahead.
They take them out there on that shooting range, okay, the first time they may take them out there, the bullets will be flying everywhere. You don't see anything on that target. But after about
this
the second
good,
or
y'all.
Third time, guess what? That they are targeted. They are aimed. And they are intending to shoot
my
their
God.
Bullseye target. And so that's the way our prayers have to be as intercessors, dead on target, not praying amiss, not praying aloof, not praying lacking fervor and power, but we've got to be dead on target with our intercession.
Ooh, look at here. I'm liking what you talking about this sitting your seat, because I be trying to tell people, y'all don't get this stuff together. Y'all gonna set it down somewhere. She says, sit in the seat. Now, I'm looking at this thing. It says, so what are you waiting on? Sit in your seat. You said intercede, cover, travail, fast, ask, declare, love, motivate, correct. Observe, admonish, assess, mentor, educate. In other words, do what the scripture says, occupied until he come. OMG. Let me tell y'all something. She talked about the love. She talked about admonishing. I mean, she just been breaking it on down. Let me tell y'all something. And she's an educator. So when you're in the marketplace, it's some things that we need to take out there in the marketplace. You understand what I'm saying? We got to observe what's going on around us. But what I like what she was talking about, motivating, but the love. Let me tell you something. When we in the marketplace and people don't know our God or our daddy, you understand what I'm saying? Uh-huh. What is going to draw them in the marketplace where you work at? What's going to draw them to know who you know? So when you've had that love in there, I said, oh, my God, I just lay on down in the radio station on that one. I just lay it on down. But, boy, tonight has been, oh, my God, this, y'all just don't know. My heart is good. I seen my mother of counseling, Dr. Alice Millsap. How are you? Blessings. Latrice, how are you? Blessings. This is so good. Listen. This has been an amazing show on tonight. It's been an amazing, amazing show on tonight. Listen. We are getting ready to embark on something that the Father's doing. And we need to continue to show the love of God. And I want to personally thank the callers who have called in on tonight for this interview. My special guest on tonight. I'm telling you, this has been an amazing night. I want to thank Dr. Lavella McGeer. I want to thank Apostle Kelly Hennings. I want to thank Minister Tavar Nicole Hunter. I want to thank Prophetess Sandra Osborne. Oh, my God. I want to thank Minister Jesse Burtz. And I want to thank Dr. Verinda Williams. This has been amazing on tonight. I want to thank y'all for tuning in to the broadcast on tonight. It has truly, truly, truly been a blessing to the body of Christ. Listen, take these nuggets. We couldn't give you everything, but take the nuggets that the Father has given us on tonight and the role of an intercessor. It has been a tremendous blessing. So I thank God for. It's been a blessing in so many ways. To God be the glory. Now listen, tune in next week, Breaking the Chains radio broadcast with Dr. Yolanda Sherman. I love you guys to life. Blessings.
Thank you for tuning in. tuning in to the Breaking the Chains radio broadcast with Dr. Yolanda.
Catch me next week.
Dr. Sherman's number one goal is to empower people with biblical scriptures.
We're going
to
deal with spiritual mothers, the heart of the mothers.
For more information, 832-263-8759.
We're going to deal with it.
Or
my spiritual mother, Lady Tammy Stewart, and my bestie best, my big sister, Lady Gail Johnson. Meet us here next Friday, Rhema Gospel Radio.